This program is a presentation of UCTV for educational and non-commercial use only.
Tara Lamont from the University of California Office of the President, and it is my very great pleasure to be the moderator for the overall Sustainable Design Best Practice Award winners. I always think that if this were the Oscars, this award would be not only for best movie, but best director, producer, and actor, because putting together an integrated building design with the constraints of budget, schedule, and just plain politics is completely a miracle. And without further ado, I will introduce the miracle makers who are going to present their projects today. The program is that I will introduce all of them at once, and briefly, details are in our program, so I won't read. We will first look at Harbor College, Los Angeles, Community District. Larry Eisenberg, who needs no introduction, will say a few words, and David Hart, the architect from Steinberg Architects, will be part of the presentation. Next, Bill Starr, who is the senior project manager at UC Davis, which is a very modest title for someone who I always think of when they say individuals make movements. He does tremendous work on his own and has managed to influence his whole campus. And he will present the Veterinary Medicine 3B project. And last but not least are three very enthusiastic people from Cal State, Cal Poly, and they will present the Center for Science and Mathematics project, Barbara Queen, who's a project architect from Cal Poly, Ted Hyman, who's the managing partner of ZGF Architects, and Peter Ramsey, who's done cutting-edge work in sustainable mechanical and engineering systems. And the three of them will present, and they wanted to take the whole hour and 15 minutes, and I had to stop them in their tracks. So we're going to be giving each of the speakers 15 minutes, and it'll be good to hold your questions, unless you absolutely have to the end, and hopefully we'll have a lively discussion. With that, Larry, do you want to?
This is an AIA CEU, so we have the official slides in our presentation. Can you put our presentation up? Okay. Can I click? It's not clicking. The advantage of going first. Aha. All right. So I've been at this conference, like I think almost every time since it began, and I stand up and I talk about our program and I wave my hands and say how fabulous it is, and I got nothing to show. Well, this year I got something to show, and we're at a fabulous point in our program. Things are moving along in a radical, rapid way. We have 30 buildings under construction. We finished 8 buildings that are LEED buildings, and we have a lot more coming, and it's very exciting. I'm just going to do a real quick overview because I'm going to let the brains behind one of our projects, which is our award winner this year, show you the project and talk a bit about some of the concepts. But I wanted to just quickly talk about some of the policies that we created as a way to provide a framework for the architects that are working with us to work against and work with our users to make it a reality. The board, of course, adopted our policy in 2002, which gives us an advantage over most everybody else because we've been working on this for such a long time. And it's taken a lot of effort and a lot of really bright people to make it come together. Now it has. The board policy basically said that every building would be built to LEED certified standards. In 2002, they were really afraid that it would cost more to build to LEED standards. And that was probably a legitimate concern. But what we're finding as we're building now is that it costs the same or less to build to sustainable standards. They also put in place a renewable energy goal. It was a modest goal, 10% of the energy from renewables would power these new buildings. We took that to another level, as I noted on the slide. We're working towards 100% renewable energy, all our colleges. 2010, we will be 100% renewably supported, all 9 colleges across LACCD. Thanks to the voters of our district, last November, we got a little shot in the arm, a $3.5 billion shot in the arm that is letting us do 50 new buildings. And we evaluated what had happened under our earlier bond program, our ANAA, and we realized that we left a bunch of the LEED points sort of on the floor. And we realized we needed to do something to help our architectural teams understand what we wanted. And so we have now created a book that we call the Sustainable Design Guidelines. Sustainable Design Guidelines go through every division in CSI and indicate what is the sustainable solution within that division or solutions. And then the architect gets to pick and use their creativity to bring it all together to make that happen. It crosswalks into LEED, so you can see what LEED points are available if you do those things and make that come together in that particular way. That book will be available online momentarily. It may be already there. You might want to take a look, because I would recommend that any institution grab it, use it, make it part of your specifications. So go to our website, laccdbuildsgreen.org. laccdbuildsgreen.org. Find it, download it, use it. It's a great guideline for any architectural team to build green, sustainable buildings. The other thing that we thought we would do with our Measure J money is explore new frontiers. You know, that's what we do, just like Star Trek, right? Space, the last frontier. So we're working on zero energy buildings as our next step. And we hope that the 50 new buildings we'll build under Measure J will be zero energy buildings, that they'll produce more energy than they consume to make that happen. And the guidelines talk about how to make that possible. So that's what we're up to at this point. Those are our next buildings coming out of the chute, zero energy. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to David Hart from Steinberg Architects. David is really been doing a lot of work. His team at Steinberg has been helping us at several colleges doing master planning and designing a couple of really brilliant buildings. Not a couple, a lot. And David's going to share what we've been up to at Harbor College.
Okay, so Harbor College, it's the southernmost college, as you can see here, down by the harbor. You know, that may be good, so let me just turn this on. It's already on. Can you guys hear? All right. Great, because I'm going to be turning. most of the buildings at Harvard College hadn't really been touched. It was founded in 1949. Most of the buildings were built shortly thereafter, and not a lot of attention had been given to the college, as is the case with many community colleges throughout the state. With the three bond measures that Larry talked about, the campus, every single building, every single inch of the campus will be touched and transformed, either through renovation or new construction. and this will include 8 lead projects on this campus alone. Okay. All right, it's always weird when someone's down there with equipment. Sorry, get a little nervous. Just a few statistics about the project. It's 2 buildings, treated as one project through the U.S. Green Building Council. They are LEED Gold. They opened in January, $38 million in construction cost, 100,000 square feet. The campus energy projects include a new central plant. And then one of the things that Prop J is doing is building a 2.4 megawatt photovoltaic farm. The energy for the building is estimated savings of 642,000 kilowatts, estimated savings of $96,000 a year, and that's 36% below Title 24. We expect to save another 20% on our electrical costs after the PV farm is in. So some green highlights: 96% of the waste diverted. Our goal was 75%, and that was exceeded. Local materials plus 20. 90% of the steel content recycled, which was amazing to me. Aluminum, not 39% recycled. Concrete, fly ash, you can see the pieces here. What I'd like to talk about, and I'll speed along, is really talk about the envelope, building performance and people places. And I think that that is one of the things that the policy at the district level is giving direction about the performance characteristics of the projects. But when we're really dealing with the users and we're making spaces for learning, it really is a people-oriented exercise. And I thought that it was well captured by the keynote speaker this morning. I'm going to talk about the student services building first. This is a building that has the benefit of running in the east-west direction. And so it's a nice elongated scheme with offices facing north and a nice lobby space to the south with a 16-foot cantilever allowing for, in the winter, as you see here, at the winter solstice, the ability to have deep penetration of light, and in the summer, no penetration of light into the lobby area. Office spaces and also conference spaces. And one of the things that's already happening is all of the conference spaces are equipped with video conference. The colleges are not traveling around to district meetings. They video conference, so Larry can communicate with the president of the college from her conference room or from the larger conference room. So using technology to keep cars off the road, the buildings, so long as they have the right technology, can help implement those sorts of strategies. The large overhang, as I mentioned, but then of course small overhangs and then operable windows. How many mechanical engineers do I have in the audience? Okay. Our mechanical engineer said you don't need to have operable windows. Operable windows don't help our energy. They don't really help anything about the calculations here. We wouldn't put them in. It's part of the culture on the campus to have operable windows. It's one of the things that empowers the users to be able to control their environment. And so we put them in, and I'm glad to see that we see them cracked open on a regular basis. So nothing against mechanical engineers, but a lot of the quality here of what's on the calculations versus what people want and how they use the space, I think that's just some of the subjective things we need to consider when looking at the project. And then, speaking of calculations, I'm going to move over to the Northeast Academic Building. We do typically model things in this fashion, sort of rudimentary things when we're doing the massing and studying the building. This is a building that doesn't have the benefit of the east-west orientation, only for part of the building, and then we have a large north-south component. Some of the key elements to this project are the clear story, which brings light into that central cavern of space. So we have classrooms on either side here. And these are things that in looking at whether we would do a clear story or whether we would do light scoops, we did a series of physical models. So this is a physical model. It happens to be on the roof of our office downtown. That's why you see high rises. But taking light measurements in here and really determining the quality of the light. The light scoops, which would face south, actually performed better. That's the orange. We actually went with the yellow, which was near the same quality of performance, so that we got some change in light quality throughout the day. We got views out. So again, taking the calculations, doing them, and then making a subjective decision about what we want to do. And part of that had to do with the first floor, which the yellow line had higher variations in the light. So you had higher glare at one end versus the other. So we looked at the benefit of this at the lower level for this clear story space. Another challenge to us was this west-facing area with classrooms and labs. And so we looked at the thing that many architects face, vertical fins. Do you orient them westward, southwest, north, northwest? So we started to test that, and we test it with a model with our light meters, et cetera, and we simulated the different times of the day, took different times of the year through those measurements, and then also took photographs of the quality of these. So these are half-inch scale models to be able to get this sort of light quality. And then you can see the spaces with the non-professional photography. You can see the light, a little bit of glare here, but this is the computer labs on the first floor. These are the light fins along the edge. And sometimes these building envelope solutions turn into nice amenities for the campus, like a modern arcade. That's the last thing I had. So who's next?
Had a very fortuitous last-minute change in the program when I ran into Lynn Feiler, my project architect and manager from HOK. So she's going to, we've worked on this presentation in the past together, so we get to share it again. So Lynn Feiler is a senior vice president from HOK that's been with us since the beginning on the project, and really has been a wonderful ally in terms of as we've had questions to run additional simulations and both the good and the bad surprises that come up on any project. We're typically on the phone a lot trying to work through things. So. Thanks. So VetMed 3B is a four-story veterinary medicine building that's mainly for research for 55 faculty members. There's another 350 staff people that are staff researchers or students or postdocs. So we had a large variation of population. Most of them are working in the areas of physiology and microbiology, so it's a lot of bench-level work. The fume hood count is relatively light, and I'll talk a little bit about that further, but just to give you a little bit of orientation, this is from the southwest. This is a plaza in the front of the building. There's the main entry here. These are all offices on the south-facing elevation, some team spaces stacked in this area, conference rooms and break spaces here, and then this vertical element here is the primary stair that was one of the early discussions about how to encourage on a multi-level building people to use the stairs and not the elevator. And the concept of having a stair culture was one that many members of the team really liked and we've continued to encourage. There's always this issue of how do you make that both a element that reads in the facade as well as in the interior. So these are some of the big goals in our sustainability objectives. So they're pretty basic. We had the advantage of having completely. We had lower level of technical issues associated with the labs. The labs are relatively generic, so it enabled us to really focus on the quality of the spaces inside. Project sits on the southwest side of the campus. This is the central core. The Arboretum waterway runs through the campus in this place, and then VetMed 3B begins the site of a future quad. So here's the site. There's a VetMed 3A was a research building that was built a couple years ago. It's been operating for 2 years now. There's a classroom building, Valley Hall here. And then there's a pedestrian link over to this research building, VetMed 3B. There's a north-south bike path here. And the main vehicle access is along this road here. And this is the future quad that's gonna be developed. So there's already been some studies of how buildings will fit around that. Now, Lynn will run you through the plans. And you want me to do that?
That's the laser. That's
great. Okay, thanks. Okay, this is the first floor. On the four-story building, we basically have three floors that are identical, the second, third, and fourth floor. But on the first floor, we're housing the administration facilities for the vet school, plus a small animal vivarium and a freezer farm. A lot of our planning concepts, which led to much greater building efficiencies than we would typically have, revolve around shared circulation and the use of open office space and team spaces actually as part of that circulation path. This is the typical floor. And as you can see, the labs are oriented on the north. We did that to get the maximum amount of daylight with the minimum amount of glare in the lab. Dark blue spaces in the center are lab support spaces. Green areas are open office spaces for students. And then the research offices are on the south side. The facade on the north side is much more permeable, much larger areas of glass. And then the south side is much smaller areas, basically punched windows into the open offices, and those are also operable windows. A few of the things that really made a difference right at the beginning is instead of just going straight to energy efficient systems is that we actually really looked at the efficiency of the program and the efficiency of the spaces. So again, we were able to achieve a 65% efficiency in the lab building, and some of the renderings on the bottom shows some of the areas we concentrated our efforts, the open office areas, which is right here, and then personal workspaces. We worked with the lab folks, the faculty, actually to pull the personal workspaces out of the labs. It made the labs smaller, thereby decreasing our energy consumption, and actually made much nicer and more healthful space for all of the researchers outside of the lab. So the center one is our research faculty offices and open office spaces. And then on the far left are open labs. And we went for a generic open lab plan that allows for user customization over time.
Okay, so just to hit on a couple foundational points here, the mechanical system in laboratories, as many of you know, is the energy use is dominated by ventilation, actually providing ventilation for the laboratory space. So just to give a proportion here, this is the ventilation component in a typical lab building versus in an office or a classroom building. So you can see the ventilation requirements are bigger than the entire energy requirements of these other building types. So there's a lot of work done within the team to really optimize how the ventilation worked in the building. One of the things that we focused a lot on was how to right size in the beginning, but then make sure we had an upgrade path to really deal with the fact that we know that uses change over time. And this was one table that I was really encouraged to see when we looked at, okay, what happens if we add more fume hoods? What happens if we have more heat load in a particular area? And so Dick Powers, a mechanical engineer at HOK, had done this table to really look at how much capacity we could get by varying water temperature versus the airflow. And it really gave me and the rest of the people on campus a sense of comfort that, okay, we could deal with these changes over time in a very effective manner. One of the things that really helped out in the design was this clear layering of the schemes. It enabled us to have a relatively generic open lab, some specialized support spaces, and then this kind of constant office area on the south side. And it enabled, because there was so much continuity in the plan, to really focus on these areas and put a lot of analysis into it. So on the ventilation side, the strategy was to use chill beams in the north side, cascade the air down into these fume hood alcoves. We used chill beams again in the open office areas and then went to radiant panels that served as light shelves in the closed offices. So this is how that looks in section. You can see this is the office side with the radiant panel that's doubling up as a light shelf in here. The chill beams are serving the open offices, the lab support, and the exhaust, and then the airflow works through here, back out the exhaust air handler, and then we're recovering heat to the lab air handler. And you can notice a very clear separation between the lab ventilation and the office ventilation. So this is designed to be able to turn off when the offices aren't occupied. The lab has to run 24/7, although we are designing it for a setback period in unoccupied mode. So So these are the results we ended up with. You can see we had the blue is essentially the baseline if the building had been designed to code. So we got a huge savings on the supply and fans and on the cooling plant. And then surprisingly, we actually got also big savings on the heating side, both the zone and the air handler unit heating. I'm going to go forward. In the daylighting analysis, there was a lot of work done in both modeling and software tools to try to really narrow our focus on the quality of the light as well as the quantity. And so Lynn had mentioned in an earlier presentation this morning about how we were really pushing to try to get the daylight to work as well as possible in the space. And just to illustrate the synergy or the challenges it has when you start working back and forth in these buildings, this is the CFD modeling done to look at the space temperature in the private offices. So if you look at these are cross sections of the office. This is a person sitting at a desk. Their computer's on top of the desk there. This is the light shelf, both inside and outside. This is the exterior wall. So on a 100-degree day, we saw that the radiant panels just weren't providing enough cooling because there was so much heat gain coming in through this upper clerestory. And the way it got put to me when I got the phone call was, we got a problem. We've got a guy with his head on fire coming off of this plume here. And it captured my attention completely, versus if somebody said, we've got a higher percent dissatisfaction rate in the occupants, it wouldn't have got my attention as quickly. So basically, we came back in and applied, and the design team worked out these intermediate fins to shade that, and you can see once that was blocked at that glass level, we were able to the radiant panels could serve that entire load. So Lynn, you want to take it from here?
Some of the other strategies we used were working with not just the lightness and reflectivity of our materials to increase the ambient light, but also use a combination of task and ambient so that depending on the daylighting situation, in many part times of the day in many parts of the buildings, actually our ambient light would be off and users would be able to just function with the task lighting. We also worked pretty seriously on the glare in the labs, trying for very large window apertures on the north side, but being mindful of the research that's being done and the importance of eliminating glare. So we looked at translucent glazing, interior light shelves. We looked at a whole bunch of different options on the column covers and studied those for glare and contrast ratio to make sure that our design solution was making a really great workspace in the lab. So our final solution was actually coming to an area where the daylight glazing up above is translucent, and the canted column covers really ease that transition from the brightness to the dark surface on the north. So these are our studies that we did throughout the year, and very iterative, back and forth. You think you find a solution at one time of year, and then it's really failing at another time. So a lot of alternatives were examined. Artificial lighting was analyzed the same way, and for instance, in the labs, which is the model on the lower left, we looked at nighttime lighting situation, and then we looked at actually the materiality of bringing in white solid shades over the windows, which dramatically increased the ambient light at night. And again, in the center, we looked at balancing the daylight fill with a parallel light fixture on the wall, but this is the nighttime configuration for that open office space. We spent a lot of time on lighting controls, really wanted to think about how everyone uses the space, giving the users opportunity to actually turn off and on the lights, but having certain areas that were only controlled by occupancy sensors or photo sensors, so that it was responsive to the conditions, whether it was occupied or whether it was daylight, but users also have the opportunity, whether through task lighting or other certain lighting, to turn on the lights. So.
Yeah, this was an interesting one. We actually did the energy work on the lighting, was we did achieve 24% savings on that, but what was fascinating was it changed. So in the design case, we actually increased the proportion that lighting made up, obviously, because we had gotten a lot of savings on the HVAC side as well. So it's interesting watching when you go to these higher performance buildings how the traditional rules of thumb of where energy is going in the building sort of change. On the water side, this was an area where I think we knew pretty much what we were doing on the domestic side, but really in the lab areas, it's this need for pure water that really drives, because typically these water systems use a large amount of water to generate a small quantity of very pure water. And so the first thing we literally looked at was, what is the cost of delivering all these waters? You can see, you know, for our campus, utilities water is what we use for irrigation. It's got a certain price and a disposal cost. But then when you get up into these high-grade waters, it doubles on up. And I just thought for information people can look at, if you actually try to do it with bottled water, it'd be a bit pricier there too. So the main thing is really start on this conservation first, although we did go with a reuse system. We really drove the conservation first. This is a slide from the Tahoe project that just shows a relatively straightforward system where we're collecting rain and snow into tanks, filtering it, and flushing the toilets. In our situation, we didn't have the regular rainfall that the Tahoe Basin does, and so we did this kind of diagram to start looking at all the different sources and where we could potentially divert them and stuff. And it's really important, I think, if you're looking at water, to try to do some kind of diagram like this and get some quantities on it. We did some site work, but I'll skip over that in the interest of time. This is the graph that where we tried to match up the toilet flushing need to the actual different water sources that we had looked at we could potentially capture. And you can see, essentially, we're able to satisfy all the toilet flushing needs except for the when we have no rainfall at all during the summer, and we're still being able to provide 75% of that. And this is an area where we were fortunate to have a relatively constant supply from the RODI system flushing, as well as from aquatics program in the building. So this is how that system works actually on the building. We've got roof drains draining into a reclaimed water tank and several other sources, water softener, flush down treatment, aquaria wastewater, all go into this tank, and then they're used to flush the toilets. So on that domestic side, we end up with almost 83% savings in water. We're still drilling into the whole issue of the water use for things like autoclaves, glassware washers and stuff, which have significant usage as well. So here's the team. A lot of great people in this team I can't speak enough about, but HOK has been a real leader in this in trying to keep the process alive, and we've had a lot of great consulting firms working with us on it, and this is just the small list. So this is where we're ending up currently. The project's finished with construction drawings, and we're ready to bid. And we're standing pretty much in the LEED Gold category. But a note on greenhouse gas emissions. So we looked at the greenhouse gas emissions on this. We were able to, through the energy conservation measures, to reduce that by half. But what was really kind of enlightening was that there's still huge amounts of carbon just by the act of construction and operating the building afterwards. And I don't mean to be too glib, but the state budget has sort of been able, they've been able to emit or avoid emissions of this amount by not funding the project for construction, which we're waiting on now. So that's where we stand at this point. Thank you.
So as with every new idea, the Center for Science project began with a vision. Our College of Science and Math department had an overreaching vision that encompassed a vision for the campus, the students, and for energy savings. Sorry. So for the campus, the vision was to create a unifying landmark for the environment. The building was to embrace an efficient design and an effective use of our natural resources. For the students, the vision was to create a building that would inspire new ideas. The College of Science and Math was an active participant in our selection process for the design team. They issued an open letter to the architects that outlined their project objectives. And I'm going to go into those major goals for the project. The slide you're looking at here is a rendering of one of our major entrances to the building, and that would be accessed from our future Centennial Park. So the creation of a unifying landmark for the college, they saw this site as a central piece to the university. And as you can see, the site is centrally located on our campus. The goal was to create a gathering place for the university. So targeting an efficient design, the team was tasked to create a building with an exterior that was timeless and enduring, an interior that was quiet and comfortable, consolidating and hiding as much as possible the mechanical systems and the service areas for the building, as well as creating an effective, sustainable design. In support of the vision, the college has generated $20 million in private and donor funding that is going towards creating additional assignable square footage for the building that will allow interaction spaces, as well as a Centennial Park area that will create this gathering space, and is also going towards sustainable design features for the building. And Peter and Ted are going to talk to those features.
So, when we were retained for the project, I think the first thing, Peter and ZGF had just finished doing a project, a lab building that had incredibly high aspirations, net zero energy, net zero water coming off the site. And the thing we learned from that project was the engineer, you got to find an engineer that's at the table. Peter thinks he designed the architecture, and I know I designed the mechanical system on the building. And it really is about an integrated process where we really worked together from the very first days in designing the building and had lots of debate. Peter was telling me how to do the exterior wall, and I think I told him how to do the skin. So he'll want to talk to the architecture too, I'm sure. When we started the project, the dean had a really wonderful vision, and I got to make sure I press the right button. This is the major ring road around the campus, and another major road through the campus. All the dorms are up here on this side of the campus, and most of the schools are down below. This is a hill, so you're coming downhill. Most of the schools are down here. The architecture is over here. And his vision was this building, both physically and metaphorically, are really where all the kids come, in their life at Cal Poly. So they're physically, they're coming from the dorms. They come through the building or through this quad space down to the classes, and they actually, all the science classes that they have to take, because it's a polytechnic school, will be in this building. So they actually are coming through the building, program-wise, too. So he thought that was really important. And then the second thing was, the way the campus really is run, the faculty needs to be very accessible, so that the students really know where the faculty are. They're accessible all the time. The faculty sometimes had a different opinion about that, but the dean was adamant that the building really had to be a place where kids felt like they could get a hold of the faculty when they wanted to. And then the campus, the student union is over here, and our first observation was that place is just packed solid with people, and there ought to be another place in the heart of the campus where kids can go. So the idea of this park, the idea of this building really creating places for kids to go during the day to interact was really important. And then last, Barbara touched on it, the idea of the building from design during construction and then hopefully over its life of its building is really used as a teaching tool to the kids in the school. So the site actually slopes about 30 feet across the, from the top end up here to the bottom. So it gave us the opportunity to really have an entrance here on the third level into the building, a main entrance on the second level here into the building, and this, which is really the busiest corner of the campus, probably for pedestrians, a third entrance into the building. This, I just might add, this is the faculty office space that they had existing, which, unlike everybody else's orientations, is oriented perfectly north-south to allow all the faculty on the west side of the building just to bake in the afternoon. So the idea of doing a very sustainable, kind of naturally vented office space was really a challenge to convince them that we could actually do it successfully. Here again, this is circulation through the campus. The idea is students are walking along here. They can come through, actually walk through the building here. And then service to the building was really difficult. There's really no back door to the building. So the idea of a service yard that's kind of screened back here where they can actually do work. They have research in geology that's actually done out in that service yard. So these are kind of washed out, I guess. I don't know if there's anything you can do about that. So the ground floor, this is right on that corner. We've located all the program space that is classrooms in one area. The idea was to really separate the program for classrooms, laboratory, and office space so we can do very different kinds of mechanical systems. I'll let Peter talk about the mechanical systems in a minute. So I have a major classrooms here, and there's an interior lobby space, interaction space that the kids can spill out of after classes, and then these classes actually open out onto the park on the lowest level. The second level then is really, this is that major entrance through the building, all the departmental offices. There's actually three departments in the building. Their departmental offices are right here off of that circulation space, so everybody sees, you know, where to go when I got a question or when I got a problem. And then the labs are all on single or double-loaded corridors off of that space on either side, and this actually stacks all the way up the building like this. And the idea of, as best we could, to, even though we're trying to fit this on a site that was pretty tight, really finding a way to take advantage of the north exposures where I can. And on the south side, that's a very thick wall, so I'm protecting those classrooms, the lab classrooms, from the sun as much as possible. And then this is a pretty typical floor. Each floor then gets a series of terraces. There's one over here at the end of the hallway. The labs are all located there. And then the faculty offices around that knuckle space in the middle. And this is a larger plan, so you can see all the faculty offices around the perimeter here. They actually all have operable windows into their offices. They were a little worried about that, so Peter has added some augmentation for those really hot summer days that they can get some cooling in the space. And then the big idea is this really becomes an atrium space. There's big openings in this space that go all the way through the building with an interconnecting stair. And the idea of some kind of seating, it really isn't showing all the seating out here in this middle space. And there's actually a bench that's looking down into that double height space. You can see it here. The idea was the faculty then could do things like meet with small groups. They actually administer tests for a lot of kids who miss their tests when they're supposed to take them, and they didn't have a place to do that. So the idea is I could line my kids up, have them take a test, and keep an eye on them while they're doing that. And then, in addition to not air conditioning this whole space, it has clear story windows at the top so we can capture some sunlight and bring it into the space. We obviously on a Cal State project, there isn't a budget to do a big atrium and put atrium exhaust in. This is actually a passively ventilated, or passively from a smoke point of view, exhausted roof. So we spent a lot of time and testing to make sure we could do that without putting big fans in the building. In terms of sustainability, I won't steal Peter's show completely, but we spent a lot of the focus on energy, first on reducing the loads as much as we can by daylighting the space, really pushing down. We had a lot of debates on fume hoods, I think, at one point. I think it was a sustainability shred. The Labs 21 guys came in and talked about how many houses use the same amount of energy in a year as a single fume hood. And that got their, I think it's six houses, Peter, is that right? It got their attention a little bit about thinking about closing my fume hood and not putting them in if I don't really need them. Oops. Monitoring system, and the guys are right down here that did that. Water reduction where we could in terms of high-efficiency plumbing fixtures. Recycled materials. And then the gray ones are the ones that we had in the design. The water side, which we is pretty near and dear to my heart, but we couldn't afford those things. So if there's a volunteer out in the crowd that wants to fund some of the water things. We had intended on green roofs over the building, and then a series of cisterns on the site that would actually be outside where kids could see how much water we had collected during the rainy seasons that would then be used for irrigation and for toilet flushing in the building. And then a lab monitoring system, which I'm bound and determined to figure out how we can put in there, where we're really taking the interface and putting it on big flat screen TVs in those atrium spaces so kids can see, if I go close my hood, you know, what it does to the operation of the building. So we're going to get that somehow. Peter.
Okay, thanks, Ted. When Ted called me for this project, and he said, it's a really big lab building, it's over 150,000 square feet, I was really excited, happy, and then he told me the budget. Right? And so this is a project on a budget, and that's, you know, we've done a project at Stanford and everything, and those guys are used to spending a lot of money in their building, so you don't have to worry about it. But in this project, making sure the project fit into the budget and was sustainable, that was really what we were focused on. It wasn't about just chasing lead points, right? We're trying to find an affordable and good design and make it sustainable at the same time. So when we started talking about lighting, we set up a goal of at least 25% lighting savings. We did achieve that. And we had to spend a lot of time going back and forth with the architects about the building envelope. And that was a new thing. We had a lighting designer, we had ourselves doing the energy modeling, the architects all working through it back and forth. And we had a lot of good ideas, but we had to throw many of those away because when we priced them out, and the contractor was in the room with us, we priced them out and they would be too expensive. So we iterated several times to get it to be affordable and perform well. There's a lot of daylighting in the labs as well as the offices. We used louvers to reduce solar gain, but also bring the light into the offices. And we did the simple thing of light-colored surfaces, including light-colored bench tops in the labs, which is the traditional black bench top actually results in a really high or an additional amount of lighting that needs to be put into the building or built into the lighting system. So with light-colored benchtops, we saved money and energy, or construction dollars and energy. So on the HVAC, this is more daylighting, just a view of one of our previous projects that uses the similar concepts of the light-colored surfaces. On the HVAC system, we use the chilled beams in labs. Same system we'd used at UC Davis on the Tahoe Center. And the beauty of that system is if it's done right, it can be set up with no reheat. And if any of you were in the presentation this morning, the big problem with the lab at Lawrence Berkeley Labs is the reheat is a little out of control. So we're designing out reheat. We're also using the AirQuity system, which is a sniffer system to be able to keep the air change rates low until a spill occurs. So it increases safety and saves energy. But as it turns out on this project, we looked at it and it was actually a VE item, meaning that we put it in as a way to save construction dollars. And the logic is that normally we have to run our labs at higher air change rates as if there's a spill all the time. In fact, we only need the higher air change rates when a spill happens. The rest of the time, the air change rates are going to be lower. So if we design for the lower air change rates, and each room on its own has the ability to ramp up, but they're not all going to ramp up simultaneously. As a consequence, we have a smaller air handler, smaller fans, smaller ductwork, right? Smaller exhaust fans. So put it all together, the AirQuity system, which is not cheap, it costs money, but it saved money on the construction side. So it was overall cost saving. So that was a really excellent win. We did obviously go with the VAV fume hoods, but there was a lot of air and a lot of, there were a few classrooms where they had 10 8-foot hoods for teaching, right? And then a couple extra ones for the professors. And so we worked with them a lot, and those started out as 8-foot hoods. And we did end up having to compromise to get them down to 6-foot hoods. But we talked a lot about teaching and is 8-foot or a 6-foot work. And there was a, after talking to a lot of other folks at other campuses, we were getting a feeling that the 6-foot would work. And that's part of, you know, making the project fit on the budget. We did obviously design very, very low pressure drop systems, so our fans are smaller from the get-go, but they're going to use a lot less energy when they run. In the offices, we used the radiant ceiling panel. It's barely detectable. It's hard to see in this picture here, but the idea is it's just a simple system that will use our medium temperature chilled water, and then we're going to supply the air for ventilation, just a little bit of air to keep it healthy with these displacement diffusers down low. And this is a diagram that we did during the project to explain the concept to everybody, because it's critical to, when you're doing something that's different, to get everybody on the same page, especially when you have the contractor in the room and they're pricing it in real time. And there were several things that we had to spend time working with the contractors because there was misunderstanding about what we were doing. We one of them was the whole idea with the chilled beams. And on this project, there was a cost estimator as well as a contractor. And they were doing both of them simultaneously, cost estimates. And we started to compare the VAV reheat system to the chilled beam system. And being a budget on a project, we couldn't put the chilled beams into the project if it was going to add money over the VAV reheat system. So we priced it out, and you can see here's the chilled beams allow us to also have lower air airflow, and but we have to spend, so we spend less on the air handlers and fans. We spend a little bit more on the chilled beams, but overall, our assertion was that it was a cheaper system. So the first, the contractor came back with it would be a cost reduction to do the chilled beam system. And the cost estimator came back saying that the chilled beam system would be equally this amount more than the standard system. So we, you know, one says left, the other says go right. So we spent a lot of time explaining to the contractors and the cost estimators exactly what we were talking about. And it turns out that we had to dig deep into the details, and we don't have to do this normally, but we had to do it on this project. And it turns out that the cost estimator was using numbers for installing the chilled beams that were off by a factor of 3 or 4 because they hadn't done cost estimating on this type of a system before. Even though they're out there, this is not the first lab building with chilled beams or anything, but there was definitely a learning curve that we had to help them come up. As it turns out in labs, if you get the HVAC energy down, the lighting energy down, we're left with a huge part of the pie is the lab equipment. So in this project, we weren't able to dig into all of it, but we dug into some of it. And one of them was the vacuum pumps that they wanted to put underneath the fume hood in a lot of the labs. And we said, well, this is adding construction dollars. It's going to add energy use in the vacuum pump, but it also required that we had more airflow in the lab. This is outside airflow to evacuate the heat that these guys were putting off, mostly while they're running, but in the idle mode. And so we found this PIAB equipment that uses the central compressed air system to create a vacuum. And it applies for certain parts of the system. Not all vacuum requirements are taken away, but there's just a little bit left that they can do with the vacuum pumps, but the majority of it is done with a simple thing that's cheaper to install and ends up with a lot less infrastructure and lower energy use. Yeah, I'm just about ready to finish up here. So anyway, we did, of course, a lot of energy modeling, and on a KBTU or MBTU per year, we were at a 43% reduction. And you can see that the plug equipment, the equipment in the labs went from 21% to 36%. You see there's that thing growing when we get our heating and cooling and fan energy down. When we look at it from the perspective of dollars per square foot per year, comparing it to an ASHRAE building, We're at about 25% savings compared to the typical building from the Labs 21 database. We're at about a 60% savings. So all of this is done on a very tight budget. This project is around $400 and $450 per square foot in that range, and also a very good net to gross ratio of close to 0.7. So looking at the leads points, we spent a lot of times with the folks from Labs 21. They came down and worked with us on a lot of the sustainable features. We also looked at the environmental performance criteria, which is similar to leads for labs. But just looking at the normal lead scoring system, we're somewhere right around 44 points, and that's well above the lead gold target that we had set for ourselves. Thank you very much.
In a lot of these buildings, there are tremendous amount of plug loads for computers, lab equipment, refrigerator farms, and things like this. Is there anything that's being done to deal with all those kind of phantom loads and background loads in terms of overall energy consumption?
Yeah, the folks at Labs 21 are working on that. There's actually a Labs 21 website. I think Paul Matthew? There he is. He's been working on that. And a variety of different people have been looking at that. Whenever we look at lab equipment in a focused way from the energy perspective, we find that there's ways to reduce the lab energy use. It was really interesting this morning, the discussion about the low-temp freezers and getting some of the samples out of the low-temp freezers. I had never thought about that. But yeah, there's lots of information out there. But still, some of it we still need to research ourselves on each project as it comes up and look at where's the lab equipment energy use going to. And let's address that and talk to the manufacturers. What we found is that oftentimes it's just a matter of surveying the different manufacturers and looking at the energy use, and some have really efficient lab equipment and some have very inefficient lab equipment.
The other lab that we did together was a private institute, and we had the luxury. I mean, we go through that debate over diversity, I think, on every research laboratory building, and that in the emergency showers with a drain are the two biggest debates you have. And I think on this other project, we had the luxury of actually going in and metering every one of their labs because they were going to replicate them. And the interesting thing is the numbers were dramatically lower than even the lowest diversity factors that we would have applied. So, and we used to say when energy was cheap, you know, I've never had a building where the client's called and said, I've got too much air. But I mean, you know, because it was easy just to dump tons of energy into these buildings. You can't afford to do that anymore. So having the ability to find out what they're really using, if you have that luxury, and then thinking about where the science is going to go, and it's the only way to get to these net zero buildings. We just can't keep dumping energy into them anymore.